Sunday morning, get up, have breakfast, get ready, and we go to church.
It's the people that I've met have kind of made me feel better about myself.
You're there to be a part of something, not there as an individual.
It makes me appreciate all people and all walks of life.
And it will always be with me.
A young boy like me needs to be excited.
Can you imagine a load of headless gay chickens?
Hello, Kenneth, darling. Did you manage to get tickets?
Sorry, boys, but you only will get one ticket.
But there's literally no more tickets there.
A policeman friend of mine was there, and he told us about how he went down to the toilets, and there's a young boy down there, and this guy said, "Don't I know you from somewhere? Didn't you arrest me?" The policeman friend of mine was saying, "No, no, it's not me." He told us that was the rent boy that I arrested for soliciting a couple of days earlier. And they bumped into each other in the toilets at trade.
Well, ended up at trade that Easter morning.
I work over in West London at Acton Fire Station. I'm a firefighter. 2 years ago, I came out at work.
All of a sudden, I saw this throng of people, just happy, friendly.
About 2 months after that, it happened to be my birthday. And I invited a few of the guys and their wives and girlfriends down to trade.
But walking down those stairs, I think I was just actually transformed into another dimension.
They loved it. They absolutely loved it.
It's an institution with me. I don't call it trade, but amongst my friends now, it's the church.
Someone took me to trade for the first time, after, a year after I'd been going.
I was there on the first night.
And it was like, I ain't going to no club at 4 o'clock in the morning in London.
Well, there weren't many people there.
No club's worth that.
I can remember dancing to Donna Summer.
What I come down to time and time again with people is, you know, it's only a disco.
And we queued up and everything, I'm like, no club's worth queuing up.
You know, it's a disco.
Today I'm interviewing a couple of journalists for one of my essays for the communication side of my degree. It's on club culture.
Mark, what do you think the reasons for trade's unique standing on both the club and the gay scenes is?
The fact that it's at a uniquely late time slot. Mm-hmm. It opened at 4 o'clock in the morning 7 years ago when no other club was, you know, that's when clubs were shutting. This is when this club opened. You don't expect to be going out at 4 in the morning. So just going out by its nature means it's a very sort of special experience.
DJs describe it as the biggest underground super club, you know, in the UK, which I thought was rather nice sort of way of describing it, yeah.
I used to see Glenn every week in his pork pie hat and shades, and he'd be wearing these white overalls, and he'd be going, having a good time then, and I'd be saying, yeah, and then 1 week, we exchanged numbers.
How are you? Well, so are we.
My boyfriend and I go to trade on a regular basis. Okay. It gives us a chance to relax, open up our minds and open up our hearts and tell honestly what we think of one another.
I mean, I started coming down to visit him on his days off from the fire brigade. And there are very few people that you really click with in this life, you know, and I instantly felt at home with Glenn.
And it's helped us in our relationship. We've been together 3.5 years. Trade has actually helped to create an atmosphere to get rid of all the stress and understand each other on a regular basis.
Since I've been here, Glenn has only had a couple of what I call long-term serious boyfriends, and I never stopped him seeing anyone. I never actually said to him, you know, I'm really upset that you've gone off with someone else, that you should be here for me. It was never an issue, right from the word go.
We're going through a stage now, we're discussing getting married later in the year.
It's the final thing with us. It's the final showing of how much we feel about each other.
What we do hope to happen is to have a registrar turn up in the back part of the club at possibly around 10 in the morning, Sunday morning.
Yeah.
It's the wedding of the century.
The wedding of the century.
So So Lawrence Smallis, how much of Trade's success do you feel is down to him?
Very large part. It has to be. He's the promoter.
Yeah,
the boss.
Definitely, yeah. He is a star. Really? He's definitely a star.
Yeah, and he can, like stars, he can be a moody little bugger and throw tantrums.
Totally, yeah. Well, he's the only person I know who can fall into a swimming pool backwards in a moodly suit and still not spill a drop of his drink, and I think that's pretty good.
Lawrence Malice had this image and he's always stuck to it, yeah. And it's always been very much his club and his idea. And he opened Trade as a place where his friends could go, and because of that, it stayed true to itself.
We love you, Chabot. We know this is going to be a successful day.
Let's do it.
Let's go for it.
To me, it is a family. I can go down there. It's one of the very few places I can go to in the world by myself, and always know that I'm going to end up meeting up with nice people down there.
Did you manage to get tickets?
So who were you going to bring down with you?
Eden.
Well, what
title Irish kid? He could have bought his ticket 6 weeks ago.
They're actually going to be selling them at the door.
There's literally no more tickets left.
When Axl Rose turned up, when Guns N' Roses were touring in this country, and turned up the door, he said, "We're sorry, we can't let you in." He said, "Why?" He said, "Well, you've made a homophobic comment. You can't be allowed into this club because, you know, it's a gay club. You can't come in. Why do you want to come in?" And we just embarrassed him so much, he walked away. We didn't want him in there. We don't want people with bad attitude.
Have you got that shirt? Trade venues.
We had a phone call asking, would it be possible for Madonna to come down to the club and could she have a separate entrance and all this? And, you know, I mean, Trade's not about that. I don't want stars down there that have got an attitude problem. We've had those things before. These people are not allowed through the door. It's not about who you are, it's what you are as a person that counts. We get people from every single walk of life going down to the club.
I'm a doctor and I came here for additional training. It was never my intention to stay. I'd been in the country for about a year when I met James, and we recognised immediately that we had something very special and very unique. I'd heard about Trade, but I'd never really been, and then I went for the first time, and it was completely different to anything I'd ever experienced, completely new, completely exciting. There's nothing like that in South Africa, and I realised immediately that this was something completely unique anywhere in the world.
Dance floor the one day, and there was a group of my friends huddled around in a circle, and they were putting something on the floor, and I asked them, they said, like, is there ashes of their friends, and it was actually his last wishes to have his ashes put on the dance floor, because that's where his most enjoyable times were.
As diagnosed with HIV, it was very, very stressful. My CD4 count was at one point over 2,000. I mean, the average would be about 800. And every time I went to Trade, and every time I got tested shortly after that, my CD4 count was raised, whereas it should have been dropped. So there was something about the atmosphere that meant I felt really good about things. Either I'd sweated it out, or there must be some holy power in that building that cures you.
I can remember the first time I came to Trade. I was flabbergasted, because I was just expecting it to be very hard dance. Mm-hmm. Music, which I'm, you know, which isn't entirely my cup of tea. And then I came here and I heard house music right across, you know, the board from like really good American,
yeah,
deep soulful house, and then there's speed garage upstairs, and it's mixing. It does get harder later on, but there is the variety to choose from, which and it works beautifully, it really does.
Yeah, it's a really good, it's a very simple idea, but it's very effective, you know. There's nothing more boring than going to a club and hearing the same damn stuff all night. Yeah. It's just like, really, it gets a bit wearing.
Trade was one of the clubs that I first gay clubs I went to. It was hugely instrumental in kind of opening up my musical ears to a much kind of wider spectrum. It was very influential. So, and at that point, I never imagined being a DJ there.
I'm just a normal lad from Leicester, you know.
Oh, bless him.
You know,
that travels down every week and to entertain an audience, and that's it.
We do actually all get on, don't we?
Yeah.
I mean, a tradie here, plenty of bitchiness and plenty of backbiting, but it's not amongst the DJs. It's aimed at the DJs maybe, but it's by other people normally, not between them.
There's Alan Lana Thompson.
Who's this guy? He's fantastic.
There's Malcolm Morag Dufay.
What do you want from me?
There's Steve Janet Thomas.
What? I don't like that camera business.
There's several names for Tony, actually, you know. Mavis.
I've got the groceries.
I haven't got one for some strange reason. I think it's because I'm so butch. And then there's Pete Wincy Wardman.
The funny thing about this, though, is this isn't even the morning after the gig. This is the morning after the gig.
Do you think that trade's music policy attracts a certain type of audience?
I think what's really important about trade is the fact that residents, you know, they have kept a firm residence policy. Yeah. You know, certain very... well-known American DJs have rung up and been turned down.
It's like if they fit into Lawrence's view of the world, then he'll book them. And if they don't, that might sound grand, but it's not. It's basically Lawrence he's got complete creative control over it.
He's got a very specific idea of what he wants, isn't he?
Which is why it's survived so long.
Trade is about a journey through music. First of all, it starts off with the British house, it goes into the American hard house, then it goes into the European house. A lot of straight clubs have actually copied our music policy.
It's a serious music club, it's not a pop music club or a high energy dance club.
Yeah.
You know, that's one thing that distinguishes trade from just being any other Saturday night club.
50% of those people out there are potential DJs.
Who are DJs?
Yeah.
No, I'd say 100% of the crowd's potential.
My name's Graham. I live in Braintree. I've lived here for 18 years. When I went to trade, it was my first gay nightclub ever. And it was a big turning point in my life. I was walking down the stairs in trade, and it was just like, it was all dark. And all I could see was just like these pink things like glowing up in the dark. Yeah. And then I saw these people, and the music was just really loud, and it was just like this big happy vibe just went rushed into my head. And then gradually, as the night went on, I sort of felt more and more relaxed, and I was thinking to myself, it's not bad being gay, you know, it's not wrong. You know, what were those people talking about? It changed the way I thought.
Under the immigration rules, same-sex relationships are not recognised, and there's no ways of me staying legally, for us to stay legally together. At the moment, the way it stands now with the Tory government in power, you can make an application to stay on the basis of your relationship, but they're very rarely granted. If Labour wins, they've promised to put the whole thing into a policy with criteria, which we'll meet easily, or we'll just have to fight it all the way to the European Court of Human Rights if necessary.
I've got a completely different outlook on gay people. I'm still not happy with myself. I need to sort of talk it out with someone, get it all out, get all the crap out.
I've got rights like every other person in this country, and there should be equal rights for everybody. So we're willing to fight the cause.
Whatever happens with my application, there's no way that we're going to be separated.
I'm really desperate to get to London. Every time I go there, I feel like it's home anyway. So I know I'm going to end up there one day. Braintree has done my head in so much. The atmosphere and the vibe of this place, they're all against gays. So I just want to get out into London so that that weight just goes away.
Isla Stewart, the Labour Party. 23,000.
Tonight's election night. We need this Labour government to help our cause. Jack Straw, hopefully he'll be the right Home Secretary, has said he would look at the immigration rules, especially for same-sex partners. This is what we want at the end of the day.
It's a big relief for everybody. Everybody absolutely needs a laughter. So am I.
We're going to throw one party at trade. All our friends will come. The whole family will be there. That will be rest assured. And that's the day that we're actually looking forward to. For that's the day that's keeping us going through this.
Welcome to Gay Pride. Welcome.
trip to such a disaster? No, the generator's gone off because someone's plugged in the vibrator. Well, I don't really think it's safe to walk through here at the moment.
There ain't no sand, anyway.
We've ripped them off enough already today. Oh, no, I didn't mean that, really. Oh, no, this is a tragedy. I tell you, this is the worst thing that could possibly happen. When your lights go down and your sound goes down and the rain starts to pour.
There's always last-minute hitches. They delivered the wrong tent, and they didn't deliver the dance floor, but it seems to happen every year. It doesn't know how far in advance you order it, but it's always some sort of cock-up. It's all about fantasy and humour. And when the humour stops, I won't be clubbing anymore.
Dance floor is now open.
Straight mate of mine in Fire Brigade, and I'll tell you what, it's the best you'll ever meet, mate. I'll tell you what, Fire Brigade, we're all mates together. Trade, the best experience.
One day. Ow!
Happy Pride!
This is my first Pride, yeah. I'm quite excited about it, actually. I don't know what I'm going to do. I'm going to walk about and see what's here and then sort of end up in the trade tent, probably. So.
We've been in touch with Turnmills, yeah. And unfortunately, the license to get married in a nightclub, they have to have a special license. But we're still planning on getting married properly about October time.
It's definitely going to happen, but I think we're having an argument as to who's wearing the dress and who's wearing the suit at the moment.
Divine.
Where's it going?
About 2 weeks ago, I actually rang up my parents and told them.
And I've told my sister now. So everyone is definitely expected to come off, so...
And of course, the reception's going to be held at trade.
Yeah. Where else?
Well, I've got a boyfriend at the moment. He said I might be able to move in with him in a couple of weeks. I just want to be happy. Happy with who I am, what I am. Because I'm still not fully competent with myself, you know what I mean? I'm just always, permanently now, and I'm doing it now, always assessing what I'm saying, how I'm saying it. And because I'm doing that all the time, I can never talk properly, I can never communicate with anyone. Like, seriously, or whatever. It does my head in.
My son wanted me to go to this gay nightclub. You know, he insisted. And I thought, yeah, have a look. What you do. So I did.
Well, I was like, my boyfriend took me there, and I was like raving on about it. Man, this club's wicked, man. You've got to come down. It was cool. I mean, me and my mum are mates, really. I mean, ever since I was little, she's taken me to the Reading Festival with her. And so we're not really like mother and son. We're more like friends. We've grown up together. So, I mean, I don't like to escape from her. I like to party with her. I mean, she doesn't come out with me all the time. She's not a fag hag or nothing, but... Do you know what I mean? We party together and we enjoy ourselves. So, yeah, it's cool.
The weird thing is, everyone looks familiar.
I finished my A-levels at the end of June, and I was going to move to London straight away, but I've got a pair of a few debts, and I've, got a new boyfriend, so I'm going to be staying there till about September, October time, then I'm moving down to London, whether we're together or not, do you know what I mean? I'm craving newness, I'm craving variety, and Oxford doesn't really cater for what I'm into at all. I've grown up there all my life, it's a small town, and I've been there and done it, and I want to move on to something new, really.
It's about time he moved on, for his own head's sake. Yeah. Oxford is a city, not a town.
That is the best tent going.
Yeah.
When trade actually travels, it no longer becomes a predominantly gay club, because what we're actually doing is exporting a music concept.
It has a much broader sort of function when it goes on tour. It's not what you find here in Turnmills, you know. So it's a different ethos, even though the music's the same.
When it tours around Britain, it is almost exclusively straight.
Yeah.
But it's bringing people in for what the music stands for, rather
exactly.
than anything else.
Yeah.
What was so funny when we went to Mallorca? Because, I mean, that's where you really find out what's going on in the world. The girls that were going around giving out the flyers said, oh, we had a bit of a problem, because every time we gave a flyer, they said, oh, it's a gay club. The girls managed to talk some of the young boys and girls into going to the club. One thing we try to do is educate people. It's the thing about music, first of all, rather than sexuality.
I played a toned-down set for me at BCM,
last night because I don't think they could take the full-on trade hard, that playing trade.
The people there definitely for the music.
Yeah, definitely.
Rather than just a lager lass just hanging out, getting drunk in any old club, people there were there to hear some music, you know.
Very much a soft spot for Malcolm, because I've known Malcolm for a number of years, and when Malcolm first turned up as a DJ at trade, he basically turned up with a carry bag with a couple of records in and says, I want a DJ here.
You know those laundry bags? I had one of them and I had like about eight records in or something that I managed to afford that week. And I said, I'll give us a little set, and he put me on at the end for about an hour, I think. And he went, oh, I really liked it, and people really liked it, and then I kind of been there ever since, basically.
Malcolm tends to be a bit more eccentric. Of course, then we have Tony de Vit. And everyone knows who Tony de Vit is. In my books, Tony is the number one DJ in this country. He's the most talented DJs of all the trade DJs.
I didn't know who Lawrence was. I just wanted to point him out in the club because it was like, look, trade had been going a year before I ever got in there.
All right.
And somebody pointed him out, and I just like sent that many tapes via all my mates. He was just bombarded with Tony de Vit tapes. He just got so bogged down with tapes. I think in the end, he just like said, stop, I'll put you on.
I mean, it's like, well, the first time I heard Tony's tape, I couldn't believe it. I thought there's something, it's very rarely people send you tapes and you start to, you question them and say, oh, there's something wrong with this. And I kept thinking to myself, there's something wrong with this. And the reason why there was something wrong with it was because it was so perfect.
I met some bloke called Dave and then he said I can move in with him. So I decided to move in and get my life together, get a job, sort my life out, sort my head out. I have to live off my own back now, and it's a lot of responsibilities I've got to do. I didn't realise I have to do my own washing and do my own ironing and stuff like that. It's little things that get on your nerves and that. I'm glad I did it, but in a way I'm not. I still wish I was at home. But if I didn't move out of there, I would have gone mad in Braintree. I'm in London now, this is it. I'm staying in London.
So I remember at the age of 14, hitchhiking up to London, sort of like the first nightclub I'd ever been to, and I just thought, God, this is amazing. The people were so at the top, and as it so happened, it was a mixed gay club as well. And I just thought it was fabulous. I'd never been to a club where I'd seen all this collection of people together. It's always your first experiences that affect you the most, anyhow.
It was actually my sister 2 weeks ago, just days before the announcement, phoned me up and said, well, have you heard the news? From that Monday, a policy had been put in place.
The immigration minister is quoted as saying that the old policy was unsustainable and a violation of human rights. They've brought in a 4-year ruling.
It's not exactly what we wanted, but 4 years to prove that you're in a relationship. We are actually a bit short of a few months.
By the time January rolls around, they'll say, well, you know, to stamp his passport and get on with it.
Once the letter comes through the door, that's when we'll have a party, definitely.
I started off by running parties in places like sauna clubs in Kentish Town Road. Most of it had been constructed over the old air vents of Kentish Town Underground Station on the Northern Line. You'd have these beautiful circular rooms. Now, I don't know what the capacity of the jacuzzi was, but at one time there'd be between 35, 40 people in there, which was absolutely ludicrous. And it cracked. The fluid from there leaked onto the Northern Line, so they had to close the Northern Line down for a while, so the woman ended up getting sued, and we ended up being thrown out.
I heard about trade from after hours parties. There was always house parties and there was obviously a need for an after hours club. Lawrence decided obviously that it'd be a good idea to set up some club, seeing as there was a demand, and they set up trade.
This was going to be the first legal after hours club in London.
Lawrence's involvement in the production and keeping the production fresh, we change it every couple of months, we have different themes. Whereas, you know, we don't have the same backdrop that's been up there for 6 years. You know, we do have themes and we do change the decor.
The theme for this year's birthday party is 7 magnificent years. So there's kind of an image from each year. So it's like a retrospective. So you see sort of history of trade sort of going around the dance floor. And there's basically 3 of us that are doing it. There's Trademark, who used to do the door at trade, and that was how he got his name. This one was used in an ad, and it's the Trade Baby kind of reworked. This is Trademark's original design. I love the image. It had clubbing used to death. This one I painted, and it was one of my favourite images from the Wild West production. I like him because he's scary. Bart as well has been there from day one, so there's his stuff. One of Bart's favourites from the 6th, the best birthday. And this is basically just taking the piss out of all the muscle Marys, you know. This guy's just got too much muscle.
I'll probably be standing in Muscle Mary Alley, spinning around like a whirling dervish.
This one was from the sixth birthday. The production was called Six of the Best. And this is another canvas I've painted, and I just think it's really woman.
Love, the tears ran down my legs.
Lawrence's effigy. this is another one by Trademark.
No second thoughts.
Got any better ideas? What to do with the Saturday?
This is one of the more memorable early pieces, and this is one of Trademark's.
Thank you, everyone. Right, get me a drink.
All the tickets have sold out completely now, and it's going to be a mad night. It is mad in the office. If you imagine a load of headless gay chickens, that's what it's like, in a nutshell.
The funniest thing is when I had a meeting once with a tax man, and he actually said to me, "What do you do during the week?" I actually laughed, because I work in an office. And he just said, "What do you mean, what do you do during the week?" And I said, "Well, I actually work in the office. I mean, trade just doesn't happen."
Lawrence.
Before you are joined into matrimony, it is my duty to remind you both, marriage according to law of this country is the union of one man with one woman, voluntarily entered into for life to the exclusion of all others. Do either of you know of any lawful reason why you should not enter this marriage? Does anyone in this room know of any lawful reason why this couple should not be joined into matrimony?
No.
And I take the science at the back.
I do solemnly declare, as I know not of any lawful impediments, why I, Glenn James Wills,
why I, Marion Josephine Lee,
may not be joined into matrimony to Marion Josephine Lee.
And to Glenn James Wills.
It gives me great pleasure to tell you both that according to the law of this country, you are now legally husband and wife. Congratulations to you.
A lot of gay relationships I know, people reach a situation in it where where they end up having an open relationship. I've been let down a lot in the past, and I just feel this sneaking feeling that two men living together is just too much.
Some of the reactions have come from the gay quarter, who find it all pretty a bit strange. I think they find it a bit hard to understand why a gay man would want to set up home and marry a straight woman.
The bedroom's a no-go area, so anyone out there who remembers the living room will know. The bedroom's our little palace, mine and Marion's.
We've both said that if I met someone that I'm happy with, I should go off with them, and likewise for Glenn.
It might seem through this all that I'm getting the best deal. I've got a strong woman by my side who I love to bits, but also I can go out and meet guys.
Straight boy.
Yeah, you wouldn't leave me alone. Oh, can you believe it? I mean, these straight boys make me laugh.
Sorry, mate, I could see you were a raving wolf there in there.
You know, I've got a wife and I've got like three kids. You know, I'm all right with
mate,
you lot.
Everything.
But I mean, what makes me laugh? They just presume that you wouldn't go with them in the first place.
First thing in my mind. The thing is, you can see he wants it.
Yeah, you wouldn't leave me alone. Paul, by the way, is my flatmate. We live together. We're friends.
Yeah, I'm so exhausted though.
Just the idea that doing this party tonight,
yeah,
I've got to sleep again at 12.
We have to sleep a few hours before.
20 hours.
Before you can come in as well, I'll come and watch me today. It's too much underneath, isn't it?
Trousers be altered.
Super, I love the champagne, darling.
Have you got a toilet? So can I have this delivered? Is that fine?
Yes.
Great.
Yes.
Six.
Get them delivered at six.
That's excellent.
No problem.
It's only Mooglet that does this, by the way.
I'm allowed to go out to play. A young boy like me needs to have some excitement.
Yes. Yes.
Cheers, thank you, bye.
Trade had a different atmosphere, very subdued. And I thought it was just my imagination, maybe people are just overtired. And then two friends came up and one just cried, said, have you heard the news? And I said, what? It's Princess Diana died. And I went, what?
And I was going out with Daisy at the time. We were going out with each other for a while. And she kept on about this club Trade all the time. And I'd never really heard of it.
I knew that he would enjoy the music, take him there, and not to worry about the gay guys, the music's so good, the lights are good, that he would really, really enjoy it.
And I was just completely overwhelmed by it. Seeing all these boys running around and everything, and you know, trying to come on to me and everything, I felt really comfortable in that environment, apart from when Daisy was there. One thing led to another, and before I knew it, I finished with Daisy and was going to Trade every week.
And I was like, oh my God, I can't believe it. And none of my friends could realise why he'd finished with me, because there was no reason. Well, he's not gay, he's not this, he's not that.
I didn't tell her straight away because I was frightened of how she'd react. And her taking me to Trade was the straw that broke the camel's back, if you like. Eventually, I had to tell Daisy that I was gay because I couldn't keep it to myself any longer.
Nightclubbing as a concept is a gay concept. That's where it started, you know. The idea of fantasy, being a star out on the dance floor, you know, fulfilling your dreams just for a night, being who you want to be, expressing yourself, you know, all that kind of stuff.
What do you think about the people who come here, the new looks that are appearing, the Muscle Marys and the Adidas Queens? Do you think they're just new clones on the gay scene?
The rise of the Muscle Marys is a new thing, and some people saying that it's a reaction to AIDS. Mm-hmm. So people are building up the bodies as, you know, to say, look at me, I'm really healthy, even though there's this terrible disease which is hanging over our heads. The Adidas clone is a new look. It's the gay lad look, which has probably came around at the time when mainstream dance culture took off in 1988 and scallies and gays started mixing together.
Do you think it's liberating at all for the gay scene to be appropriating the straight look?
Any sort of cultural cross-pollination is always very liberating.
Is it a defence mechanism, though, do you think?
I don't know whether it's, in a way, going back into the closet. You know, if you're wearing these clothes and you're talking to a group of straight people, and, you know, they go, God, I didn't know you were gay. And you always go, got you.
I managed to find work in London. I was a waiter, chef, working in clubs, bars, in hospitals, doing meals on wheels, taking food to old grannies and that, round their house and that. I didn't like any of it, so I just kept giving one job up after the other, and then ended up with no job and then no money. So then I was stuck in the house with this bloke, and we was getting on each other's nerves all the time. Lived with him there for about 3 months, and then that didn't work out either. So I've had to come back to this dump. Being gay is just, it's not bad, it's not bad at all, but people make you think it's wrong. And because of that, you get loads of, you just think about loads of other stuff that could be wrong, and then make up little stories in your head about what people are thinking, and you do it all the time. I think what I'm going to do next is get a psychiatrist or a counsellor or something. It'll probably take me about, I don't know, 6 months to sort that out. There's quite a lot in there and sorting out. So Once that's all sorted out, I'll be back in London. So watch out, I'm coming back.
Been up since 9 o'clock this morning, and I mean, I didn't really sleep very well last night, because the fact is, before we put on a major party, I started getting very nervous that the production's not going to be done properly. They're paying tonight is £25 for members and £35 for guests, which pro rata it's not expensive because we're open for 18 hours where most clubs are going to be open for 10 or a maximum of 12. We will not make any money tonight. All we will do is we'll have a busy club with a lot of happy people that will go along with a smile on their face, and that'll see us through maybe the dead months.
I have to say that I think Lawrence takes the piss.
Right.
With ticket prices, any big bank holiday, any excuse for a ticket only night, do you think that could exclude the regulars?
I think Lawrence, more than most club owners, is genuinely still very, very passionate about the music.
Definitely.
But he's also got a business to run.
Mm. At the end of the day, clubs are a commercial venture. Yeah. They're a business. You know, that's one thing that's it's part of the music business, entertainment business.
Happy New Year!
Happy New Year! Mwah.
Happy New Year.
Happy New Year.
The election night was the most memorable night of this year, I think. I was, of course, just terrified, thinking another 5 years of a Tory government won't help our cause in the slightest.
I feel more relaxed and more confident that I won't be deported or anything like that.
Our intentions is to travel to Japan and possibly Canada. Trade will be in South Africa for Valentine's night, so that should be quite an interesting one.
I was a bit kind of envious. I mean, I'd love to go to a trade club in Cape Town in February, but we can't plan anything yet.
No. Out of a whole bunch of huge circle of friends, we're the only people who haven't had a week in the sun, can't leave the country.
We don't have our passports.
Maybe I'm a bit sure of myself, I don't know. Maybe it's all going to go horribly wrong, but fuck it. You don't know until you try, do you? So there's no point sitting in my little room, my little safe life, thinking, oh, what if, I'd rather do it, fuck up, and then come back again. There's other people that have just been really negative. Like, oh, what are you going for? You're going to London, you're going to be a rent boy, this, that, and the other. So, I haven't really had that many positive reactions.
If he paces himself, he'll be all right. But if he gets caught up in the, you know, the drag of everything, and the speed of everything, he'll burn himself out. He's got to pace it, he's got to be calm. I think he'll be all right. He's got his head pretty much together.
Believe it or not, she's the one that said to me, you're going to be selling your ass at Piccadilly Circus. Could you believe it?
Of course I'm going to miss him.
No neck curtains, wrestling rubber moving, hopefully. As they are now.
We do get on better when we're not living together.
To be honest, if I'd have moved a year ago, when I originally wanted to move, I reckon I'd have been down there. Trade every weekend. And people change, don't they?
You both went to South Africa with Trade, mm-hmm. The Trade tour. What was that like?
Obviously, it's a very interesting country to go to, especially at the moment, because of just the obviously the situation it's in politically and socially and culturally, I would say, as well.
You've got Cape Town and Johannesburg, where clubbing is quite big, and then there's Durban, where clubbing is smaller still, and then there's the rest of the country where there's, in terms of what we know as dance clubs, there's not an awful lot happening.
Yeah.
So it's still very embryonic.
Kiss 100 Friday night, Pete Wardman and the Trade Crew live from South Africa. We've crossed the equator. Tonight we're live 200 yards from the beach under the shadow of Table Mountain at radio station Good Hope FM in Cape Town, South Africa. And just to piss you off, it's 32 degrees outside. You might be aware by now that Trade, the UK's most cutting-edge club, is out here for its South African tour.
You hate to die, believe me.
Yeah, it's the first time we've all been outside the UK ever on a Saturday night outside of London.
Lawrence Mallis,
Lamellis herself, the guru of trade, is here. Keep her glammed up. This is why you're late, isn't it? You spent hours in front of the mirror tonight.
Of course I have.
Tonight we got the club, which goes on until 8 o'clock tomorrow morning. So, and then from there we go to Johannesburg. We leave here about 12. So we've got 4 hours from the close of the club to get to the airport and everything.
And regards to Paul and all the trade gang in London. And look after the place while we're away.
Damn right. We ought to say as well, happy Valentine's weekend,
yeah,
shouldn't we?
Yeah, happy Valentine's to all of you. Love you all. Bye. All right, so I'll see you later.
Hello, darling. What's happening?
They're missing their tickets. God!
The problem is that journalists have just arrived in Johannesburg and they don't have the normal tickets.
They have to get a fax from the travel agent.
Trips! Coke!
God, how big is it?
Again.
How are we going to get through the front? Once you've had a bit, all these people have got tickets and last.
It's a car magazine, isn't it?
Order second hand. Yeah.
Hello.
Up into the air.
I think it's fantastic. I like the idea of people dancing in the open air. I think it's very civilised.
I remember her once. She used to DJ for me once. I thought she looked familiar. I'm not too sure she was one of those South African moms.
Actually, she only found out tonight that you're a gay club.
A lot of gays here, yeah.
But it's like cool if you, you know, if you're just chilled and stuff.
It's
like,
pretty busy inside. I don't think they're used to successful clubs. What's the bigger?
See you tomorrow. And now this bitch is gonna go to bed.
You said something about club unity that's being forgotten over here in Britain. Is it happening over there?
It's a very, 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 very white crowd.
Yeah, absolutely.
The disparity in the amount that you can earn if you're white and if you're black in South Africa is huge.
Yeah, so young black people probably wouldn't be able to afford to buy tickets to the big race.
Plus maybe. Which the young black people don't go to, aren't into the hard banging house
music anyway.
Yeah,
they're like the quarter, don't they? You got your rhymes, and I got mine. Let's just spend it all. When it comes to this new South Africa, there's a lot of our separatism between the black and white. I don't enjoy anything that's happening in town. I mean because of the past, what has happened to the past, not actually being black, but also being a lesbian among the white and colored lesbian. But here in the township, there's not such like that. There's a mixed shippings, gay, lesbian, or white. You just stay together, which is different from town.
I think it's about time to educate my own people in the township to see who I am and what I am, than rather going to the city to experience some sort of double discrimination, because I'm a gay black person.
I openly with my partner, there's my partner, I don't have any problem. I just do everything, what the straight people are doing, I'm also doing it. If I feel like kissing my partner just on the road, I just kiss my partner. There's nothing wrong, because they are also doing that.
Got back from the club about 6 this morning. Packed our bags.
Strike poles, strike poles, strike poles.
Went to the airport.
We are now departing Cape Town to go to the fantastic Johannesburg.
Checked into our rooms, 3 hours sleep. Got up, got changed. Well, in about 5 minutes. Straight to the club, back at 6 again tomorrow morning.
No, please.
Yes. Still with the trade thing on. Still with the trade
pass on. Still with the same clothes on.
No, I haven't.
We've all been saying it's been so good because it's the first time we've ever really had time to spend with each other. And it's been brilliant. We've had such a good time.
Thanks for bringing
us. Actually, we're all welcome.
Jesus,
it's just what I've always wanted.
We've had very little rest. And whether we've been sitting around all week or not, it's still very tiring.
It's not rock and roll.
There's no naked women running out my room, not down the corridors.
But yeah, I would knock it for the world.
Well, what I'm looking forward to today is to see how you can turn a disused car park into a party.
There's a crowd over here just really, really into it. But like I say, it doesn't matter who's there, they're really genuinely into it. Not just standing around, they're actually partying. It's really fresh for them, you know? It's like England, Britain was like, I don't know, 8 years ago or something, when people were really enthusiastic.
Johannesburg is a dump. It's the most violent place in the world.
Tonight, well, there's 6,000 here or something, so the contrast between the gig last night in Cape Town and tonight couldn't be bigger, really. I mean, last night was a smaller club event, you know, well, I say smaller, it was, well, you know, 2,000 people. Tonight's this massive, huge rave in a car park.
This rave rocks. This has been the best, like you said, in the past 6 months. It's compared to nothing that's ever been here. Powerful rave.
Lawrence is actually more worried about what's happening in London right now than what's happening here.
From my background, I assume rave, white. It's becoming much more integrated. I mean, I was shocked when I found out Carl Cox was black and Frankie Knuckles was black.
It doesn't really matter to me whether you're white, black, anything around me, it doesn't matter. As long as you're having a good time.
Just talking to some of the clubbers in the Johannesburg party, young, white, South African people, mm-hmm. Who just seem to be very optimistic about the future and are expressing a lot of using clubbing as a medium for people coming together, music and dancing, yeah. People coming together. And they seem to really, really believe in this concept. It's just a bit more innocent and maybe perhaps a bit naive as well in South Africa. Yeah.
When you grow up in a small town, you're sort of like stuck in the mould of the way you were. Do you know what I mean? Like, people knew you from when you were a kid, and it's like, oh, little Damon. And like, now I've moved to London, I can like create a new life for myself. I'm basically a waiter. You know, I flirt and I'm cheeky and they love it. It's been a weird year. It's been a good year as well. I mean, I finally got what I wanted and I've moved down here. No, I know I've made the right decision.
The application was refused in January. It took them about 6 months to make a decision, and then they said no, they don't believe that we've been together for 4 years. So we've lodged an appeal, and that's going to take about another year to come to court. We had a lot of money in our holiday fund and all that kind of thing, and I'm not allowed to leave the country.
Yeah.
3 weeks together, not working in London, it was nearly the end of the relationship, and
it was,
and we were both stressed out and depressed and upset, and it has opened up all sorts of cracks and, you know, caused strain.
I'm still at home in Brighton, yeah. My mum, she understands half what I'm going through, and she knows I've been going counselling. Yeah.
Graham, hi, come in. One of the things that I suggested that you might do was to focus more on the good things that are going on in your life at the moment. You can just close your eyes and just relax completely.
Last year I felt as if I was in a little metal box and I couldn't communicate with anyone. But now I know that it's okay to be me, you know what I mean? I feel optimistic, confident and excited about the future.
My biggest insecurity is not only my own venue. It's very difficult when you don't have that, because at the end of the day, it's down to the whim of the person who owns the venue, whether you're going to be there next week or not, and that is very insecure. I've always believed from a very young age that it's very wrong to gamble, and I've always believed that I was never a gambler, but I must be, because the fact is I actually hire a space on a weekly basis, and I mean, 1 week that could just change. I mean, the owner could just then decide, well, we don't need you anymore, we'll do it ourselves. And that's what makes me very insecure.